We're just here getting ready for Trunk or Treat. It's right around the corner. And we are so excited to have you and all your friends and family join us next weekend, October 28th from 6 to 8 p.m. right here on La Casa de Cristo's campus.
And don't forget, you still have one more week to register your trunk or to donate candy to the front office or the sanctuary.
So get ready for this fun and festive event as we invite our whole community and you to join us for Trunk or Treat 2023. We can't wait to see you there.
Hello, La Casa. My name is Juan Hernandez, and I'm here with Grand Canyon University. I would like to invite you to our upcoming concert, Sunday, October 29th at 3 p.m. The Canyon Choral Society, along with the Canyon Symphony Orchestra, will be performing Dan Forest's beautiful Requiem for the Living. You know, being so close to All Saints Day, it will be a great opportunity just to listen to some wonderful and uplifting music and honor those who have come before us and who are now in glory. It's a beautiful piece of music, and I invite you to come. This is a free concert open to the congregation. We would love to see you there.
Hi, La Casa family. Pastor Jeff here. We just celebrated a big confirmation weekend, and now we're looking forward to another second big weekend. It's Reformation Sunday. You want to make sure you wear red because red is the color of the Holy Spirit. This is a weekend we celebrate being Christians who are Lutherans because Martin Luther was the one who protested the root of the word Protestant and rediscovered for the church the necessity of Scripture and the fact that we are founded on the solid foundation of the Bible, not on human tradition. It's a very special weekend with a message and music. It's Reformation weekend. Don't miss it, and please wear red. And now, let's begin.
Hello, everyone. Please remain seated for this first song.
Amazing grace. May you sing grace, how sweet. We are so grateful to have these youth, these confirmation youth, leading worship today. This is their fourth worship service of the weekend, and they've done an amazing job, and you are in for a very special worship experience today. Rather than applauding after each of them goes for their individual parts, let's recognize them all now at this time, please. Up to my left here, I want to also recognize Susan Scudder. Susan has led our junior high youth and led our youth through some very challenging years here in the past few years. And so we're so grateful for her ministry with us and all she's done for our young people. So can we recognize her as well, please?
Thank you. I appreciate that. Like Pastor Jeff said, these kids have worked really hard for this weekend. But they've also worked really hard for 2 years. So this long time coming for this great celebration for an amazing group of people. I would also like to give a shout out to the youth band. These are all high school kids who had volunteered their hours yesterday and today. So let's hear it for the band.
Welcome everyone, both online and in person. For the past few years, we've been learning about God and growing our faith in Him. Now we are ready to confirm our faith, so thank you all for coming to support us on Confirmation Weekend 2023. We're all so excited to gather here and commit our lives to God. Please join me in prayer. Dear God, we are all thrilled for the opportunity to be here today and take this next big step on our faith journey. We pray that we always remember confirmation and the reason we chose to do this. We know our mission is to share your love with the world, so please remind us of that when we get too focused on ourselves. Help us all remember that this is not the end of our faith journey, and we can also grow our connection with you. We all love you so much, and thank you for loving us even more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I would like to invite any kids out for a kids' talk.
Well, hi guys, I'm Connor.
And I'm Jackson.
Does everyone know what this is?
No.
Well, it's a flashlight.
And does everybody know what this is? So, what does a battery do to the flashlight?
Help
it. Well, think of you and God like the battery in the flashlight.
So, without the battery, the flashlight doesn't work, right? So, think of our lives as, without God and the Holy Spirit, our lives don't work as well as they normally would. Have any of you ever been afraid of the dark?
Well, remember that when you're scared of the dark, that God and the Holy Spirit will always shine a light for you, just like the battery in the flashlight. And I have a verse from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline.
And now, will everybody bow their heads and close their eyes for a prayer? Dear God, thank you for always powering us in our lives and always being in our lives as well. Please help us remember that if we are ever in a difficult situation or scared, that you will always be with us and guide us through it. Amen.
I invite all of you to stand up and share the peace of the Lord. You have to go back to your seats now.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Liam Keegan. Today's reading is found in Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 8, on page 798 in the Pew Bible. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God, through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we boast in the hope and the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, at just the right time, when we were so powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, but for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Here ends the reading.
Hi, my name is Paige Craning, and I have been coming to La Casa de Cristo since I was born. I went to preschool and Ignite here and have had an amazing experience in the youth ministry so far. A couple of the fun activities that I have done include Sunday mornings, trips to new places, gym jams, girls' nights, and confirmation classes. Each held wonderful ways to make friends, grow my faith, and have fun. First off, I would like to start with the amazing things that we do over the summer. Gym jams are one of my favorite things to do. We play games like nine square, dodgeball, and volleyball. I love to invite my friends from outside the church to join me in having fun while also being at the church and in the presence of God. Vacation Bible Experience, or VBX, is one way that I love to help out at church over the summer. I went as a kid for many years and have now volunteered for 2 years as a leader. My first year I was in the nursery, and this past year I was in recreation. Confirmation camp and junior high winter retreat were both amazing camps that I am so glad I went to. Both camps helped me open myself to God and spend time with my fellow confirmands. Confirmation camp was one of my favorite and most meaningful memories that I will never forget. Mrs. Pam, Miss Carly, and Miss Susan taught wonderful confirmation classes throughout the year. We learned a lot more about the Bible and its history by watching fun videos, doing projects and skits, and having good group discussions. Girls' nights were always a lot of fun to go to. We had good food, met new people, and always learned something new. Finally, Sunday mornings are one of the best parts of the week. The messages are always so meaningful, and the music and worship is great. I love the small group discussions that we have. Altogether, the trips, classes, and social activities that I have attended over all of my years at La Casa have matured my understanding and faith in God, have grown new friendships, and made it a blast to have grown up in this church. I'd like to end with citing one of my favorite verses, 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12. Don't let anyone doubt you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Zale Simpson, and my poem is about God's love. And it's called, How Do I Know Christ Loves Me? This poem is dedicated to my grandma, my best friends, and girls' night. I know Christ loves me, for the Bible tells me so. God loves even if we don't love him. 1 John 4:7. We love God because he first loved us. God so loved us that he gave his son to save us. John 3:16. Even if there is something between us with the Lord, it will never destroy our love. Nothing can bear our love between us and the Lord. Romans 35:39. God shows us how to love others. Loving one another equals loving yourself, equals being Christ's disciple. John 13:35. Love, how to love another. Love one another as I love you. John 13:34. Love others as you love yourself. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. Mark 12:31. The three key ingredients to loving the Lord is faith, hope, and love. Love is the greatest one. 1 Corinthians 13:13. Love is needed the most during the hardest times. Love one another even at tough times. Be humble, gentle, and patient in love. I learned that Jesus loves me even as a young one singing, Yes, Jesus loves me. Therefore, I know Christ loves me because he tells me so. He loves us all. Please stand for the Apostles' Creed.
Hi, my name is Sophia Gianforte, and I'll be doing the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. What does this mean? I believe that God has created me and all that exists. He has given me and still preserves my body and soul with all their powers. He provides me with food and clothing, home and family, daily work, and all I need from day to day. God also protects me in time of danger and guards me from every evil. All this he does out of fatherly and divine goodness and mercy, though I do not deserve it. Therefore, I surely ought to thank and praise, serve and obey him. This is most certainly true. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. What does this mean? I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, Son of the Father from eternity, and true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. At great cost, he has saved and redeemed me, a lost and condemned person. He has freed me from sin, death, and the power of the devil, not with silver or gold, but with his holy and precious blood and his innocent suffering and death. All this he has done that I may be his own, live under his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he has risen from the dead and lives and rules eternally. This is most certainly true. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. What does this mean? I believe that I cannot be by my own understanding or effort, believe in Jesus Christ my Lord, or come to him, but the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with gifts, and sanctified and kept me in true faith. In the same way he calls, gathers, enlightens, and sanctifies the whole Christian church on earth and keeps it united with Jesus Christ in the one true faith. In this Christian church, day after day, he fully forgives my sins and the sins of all believers. On the last day, he will raise me and all the dead and give me and all believers in Christ eternal life. This is most certainly true. You may be seated.
Thank you. I'm Ella Aronson, and I'm a freshman at Horizon High School. When I was thinking of what I wanted to talk about in my sermon, my mom showed me a picture she had in the house. The picture was of the story, Footprints in the Sand. When I read it, I immediately knew I wanted to write my sermon around it. One night, I dreamed a dream. As I was walking along the beach with my Lord, across the dark sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene, I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to me and one to my Lord. After the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand. I noticed that at many times along the path of my life, especially at the very lowest and saddest, there was only one set of footprints. This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you sensed once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed that during the saddest and most troublesome times in my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why, when I needed you most, you would leave me. He whispered, my precious child, I love you and will never leave you, never ever during your trials and testings. When you only saw one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. This is a meaningful story because I think that most people can connect with it in one way or another. I know for me, the past few years have been very rough on me from separating from many of the people closest to me to my family challenges. For the longest time, I'd been going to church and praying, but I never really felt a true connection with God. During confirmation camp, I was given the chance to reflect on myself and my relationship with God. I realized I had been pushing away. I had so many questions as to why God was putting these obstacles in my life, and I was starting to question myself and wonder if I was the problem. At this time, I was working on growing my relationship with Him and was understanding why He was doing what He was. But I was upset with God. I feel like He wasn't truly there for me. This time, I felt like the person in the story when they saw their one set of footprints. I was lost, but then during church trips, worshiping, and trying to form a better relationship, I think God was trying to make me realize He had been there the whole time. Then I learned that God is always taking steps with me when I'm strong enough to take them on my own. At my hard times, when I need someone to carry me, He is. You just have to look there to know. We can all learn from the story and know that God knows the battles we are going through, and He is always supporting us. You just need to have faith that He's walking with us or carrying us through.
My name is Chase Wise. I'm 14. Some of you guys know me, and some don't. But I've gone through something that many people have experienced. Doubt. This starts on March 4th. That was my birthday, and I was super excited opening my presents and receiving cards from my friends. I thought that month was my month. Oh, I was greatly mistaken. I was turning 13 and playing baseball at the time. Later in that month, my grandparents were coming in town, and we went up for Cave Creek for lunch. On the way, my dad got a devastating call that would alter the direction of my life and faith. My dad received a call from my coach. My teammate, Daniel, passed. How? At that time, I didn't know, and I didn't think about it. It was a wave of memories filling up my mind. It was hard to keep my composure during lunch. The next day, my parents told me that he had committed suicide. I didn't believe it. My friend Daniel was hilarious. He brought smiles and laughs every single day to practice. I asked why. Why did he do this? So I went to the one person who I was taught to trust most, God. I prayed and asked why, but I was blinded by anger. I blamed the death on him. The next couple of months, I felt nothing. I was going through the motions, going to church and feeling a void. Later during the summer, I went through confirmation. During confirmation, the leaders held Bible studies and every night a worship. During confirmation, we had activities that made a strong bond with God. My connection with God got better, but I was still doubting because all of my friends had felt His presence except me. I kept on doing Bible studies, but I felt like I was still looking for proof and asking why. Not too long ago, we went on a high school summer trip. I told myself, this is the time. On summer trip, we went rafting and did community service projects like building houses. We also did a worship every night and had activities and Bible studies where we learned and bonded with God. For the first time, I allowed myself to open up and started saying thank you in my prayers. On the last day of the trip, I closed my eyes, I turned my palms up, and I opened myself up to anything God wanted to offer me. And he was there. I felt him. I really felt him. What he said was personal, but he showed me a glimpse of my purpose and that my experience could help others. After that experience, I started having conversations with God through prayers. It became a normal occurrence. I now have strong faith. I now realize God does everything for a purpose. No matter how blind you might be, no matter what you're going through, God is there and he hears you. He might not respond in the way or time, but he will respond.
Hi, I'm Mason Lennius, and I'm 14. Throughout all the struggles and all the adversity we may face in life, we must know that God is always with us. God has a plan for us, and we may not like his plan in the moment, but he has a reason. When I tore my ACL in January, it felt like the end of the world. On January 21st, 2023, I was ready to play the sport I love, and I felt like I was in the right place to do that. I felt like I could be the best player I could be. At that point, I didn't have the same relationship with God that I do right now. I prayed every once in a while and almost never opened up my Bible. It didn't help that when I tore my ACL, I didn't have a good relationship with God and didn't feel like I could talk to him. After my injury, I couldn't walk for almost 2 weeks and was on crutches for about a week and a half before I could start to put any weight on my leg at all. I progressed and was slowly able to put more and more weight on my knee over the next coming days, weeks, and months. By the end of February, I started to feel perfectly fine. I was wearing a knee brace, and I was playing in the backyard with my brother and friends, but I still didn't have that relationship with God. After a long 3 months, I had surgery on March 9th and had to repeat the same rehab process. After reaching a point where I was walking freely, I went on summer trip with this youth group. And it was the first time that I truly opened myself up to God, and I felt his presence. On summer trip, through many nights of worship, I realized that God has a plan for each and every one of us. His plan allowed me to serve him, his plan allowed me to learn about him, and his plan allowed me to become closer to him. God does everything for a reason. We just need to find that reason. Thank you, and at this time, we will receive our offering.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Bryson Wood, and on behalf of my fellow confirmants, I want to thank everyone who helped us with our walk with Christ. But I specifically want to thank all of you, starting with Mrs. Susan, who helped all of us throughout confirmation and the start of high school. Since the start of seventh grade, she's been our mentor. Mrs. Susan was always there to answer questions or support us with her loving and welcoming personality. I also want to thank all of our prayer responders for giving us support with what we need help with. Next, we want to thank Pastor Matt and Pastor Jeff. We want to thank them not only for their amazing messages and sermons, but for also being some of our close friends. Both Matt and Jeff have been impactful for all of us. Next, we want to thank Miss Pam and Miss Carly for being our 7th and 8th grade confirmation teachers. Both of them had something amazing to say, whether it be about God or just about personal things. Of course, we can't forget about our parents for being there our whole lives, supporting us, and for some of us, the reason why we're here. We also want to thank the cooks and the custodians for their amazing work. The cooks make great food for all of us on trips and during events, and the custodians do a great job making the church look nice. Lastly, we want to thank our older friends. They have been great role models for all of us, and they have done a great job supporting us and helping us live for Christ. Thank you.
My name is McKenna Arthur, and I'm going to share a prayer with you. Please stand. Thank you, Lord, for being in our presence this day. We are gathered here today to worship you. We thank you for your gift of the Holy Spirit. Please fill us with your Spirit, and may we be full of peace because of your presence in us. We pray by name for those who especially need your touch, for those who are hospitalized, such as Mark Hayden, for those who are recuperating, such as Dick Kulzicki, Noah Keegan, Christina Garden, Sal Ordinez, Doris Wilson, and Lois Stone. And finally, Lord, for those who have recently experienced the death of a loved one, such as Walter Yu with the death of his brother, please comfort them all and all who are hurting with the loss of their loved ones. Now, Father, we pray our most treasured prayer, the prayer your Son Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace and serve the Lord.